أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
Thank you.
رب السماوات والأرض وما بينهما الرحمن لا يملكون منه خطابا. يوم يقوم الروح والملائكة صفا لا يتكلمون إلا من أذن له الرحمن وقال صوابا.
سبحان الله
ذلك اليوم الحق فمن شاء اتخذ إلى ربه مآبا. فمن شاء اتخذ إلى ربه مآبا. يوم يقوم الروح والملائكة صفا لا يتكلمون إلا من أذن له الرحمن وقال صوابا. ذلك اليوم الحق فمن شاء اتخذ إلى ربه مآبا.
سبحان الله سبحان الله.
إنا أنذرناكم عذابا قريبا يوم ينظر المرء ما قدمت يداه.
سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله.
ويقول الكافر يا ليتني كنت ترابا.
سبحان الله سبحان الله.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
سبحان الله سبحان الله.
والشمس وضحاها والقمر إذا تلاها.
سبحان الله الله سبحان الله.
والليل إذا يغشاها والسماء وما بناها
سبحان الله سبحان الله.
والأرض وما طحاها ونفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها. والسماء وما بناها والأرض وما طحاها ونفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها. والسماء وما بناها والأرض وما طحاها ونفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها. قد أفلح من زكاها وقد خاب من دساها.
سبحان الله.
كذبت ثمود بطواها إذ انبعث أشقاها فقال لهم رسول الله ناقة الله وسقياها.
سبحان الله.
فكذبوه فعقروها فدمدم عليهم ربهم بذنبهم فسواها. ولا يخاف عقباها. لا إله إلا الله. لا لا إله إلا الله. لا إله إلا الله والله اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا
نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا ومأوانا وملجأنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله وحبيبه ونبيه صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين وبارك وسلم أبدا أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد الله لا إله إلا هو ليجمعنكم إلى يوم القيامة لا ريب فيه ومن أصدق من الله حديثا وقال تعالى في مقام آخر يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم إن زلزلة الساعة شيء عظيم وقال تعالى في مقام آخر الذين يخشون ربهم بالغيب وهم من الساعة مشفقون آمنت بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وأصحاب سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وصل عليه صلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا حبيب الله صلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا نبي الله صلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا رحمة للعالمين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending salutations, peace and blessings upon the best of creation the beloved of Allah Almighty, the coolness to our eyes, the purpose of our life The reviver of our hearts, the inspirer to our minds. The most honored one, the most praised one, the most revered one. Undoubtedly the most beautiful one. None other than Sayyiduna wa Nabiyuna Muhammadur Rasulullah. Sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa barak wa sallam. Each and every one of us who are sitting here in this masjid, the house of Allah Almighty, at this moment in time, we all as Muslims have been commanded and told by Allah and His Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam to believe in the final day. And undoubtedly, without any doubt, it is one of the major articles of our faith and of our belief system to have iman and yaqeen, to have belief and certainty in the day of judgment. As youngsters, when we used to come to the masjid, most of you will know the namaz book that we used to learn from. It is a world-renowned and famous namaz book, which used to be in like orange-bluey color. This namaz and kalima and dua book was compiled by a great scholar of Islam, especially the subcontinent. And he was very famously known and regarded as the Khatib of the Ahlul Sunnah. It was compiled by an individual called Mawlana Muhammad Shafi Uqarbi rahmatullah alayhi. And the first thing we learned when we opened that book, it was like a manual for us to learn du'as and our namaz and kalimas. Now there are modern day new types of books, but that was one of the earliest ones in this field. And it's amazing how Mawlana Uqarbi sahab had a vision. They knew that this book that they were compiling on how to learn how to pray, the units of prayer, though initially it was in Urdu and now translated into English, they had this vision and knew that this needs to be taught in the madrasa syllabus. And this is one of the easiest ways. This is why we learned that book. Mawlana Uqarbi sahab began that book with the two imams, Iman al-Mufassal and Iman al-Mujmal. The iman which goes into tafsir, detail. آمَنْتُ بِاللَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَكُتُبِهِ وَرُسُلِهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَالْقَدْرِ خَيْرِهِ وَشَرِّهِ من الله تعالى والبعث بعد الموت. And this effectively is from the sayings of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. آمنت بالله, I believe in Allah Almighty, وملائكته and His angels, وكتبه and His books, ورسله and His messengers and prophets, واليوم الآخر, and I have belief and certainty in the final day. واليوم الآخر والقدر خيره وشره, and I believe in destiny, it's good and it's bad, خيره وشره, this is all من الله تعالى, from Allah سبحانه وتعالى, and I believe in والبعث بعد الموت. بعث بعد الموت means I believe in the hereafter, I believe life after death, which is the hereafter. These are the articles of our iman. We as Muslims believe in each and every one of them. We believe in Allah Almighty and His eternal attributes. We believe in His attributes. We believe in His Zaat. We believe in all of them. We believe in all His angels. The major angels such as Sayyidina Jibreel, Mikael, Israfil, Israel, Malakul Maut. We believe in every single angel Allah has created. We believe in wa kutubihi. We believe in the books that He revealed to His messengers. And these are all the divine heavenly books. We believe in them. We believe in the Bible. We believe in the Torah. We believe in the book of Dawood, the Zabur. We believe in Al-Quran al-Kareem, the book of the Muslims, which is a book of guidance for all to the day of Qiyamah. We believe in every book. Yani those books that were trampled, the original texts. We have iman in them. If we don't believe in them, we are not Muslim. We leave the folds of Islam. We have iman in all of these books. Wa rusulihi, and we believe in every single prophet. You know, when you sit with Christians, you tell them, we believe in Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam more than you believe in. And our belief is founded on that belief. For if I don't believe in Isa alayhi salam, I'm not a Muslim. So I have to believe in the prophet that you believe in. And I believe in Musa alayhi salam. And I believe in Sayyidina Dawood alayhi salam. And I believe in Sayyidina Zakaria. Every single prophet and messenger that came from the beginning, Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, till the final prophet and messenger, Sayyidina Muhammad Rasulullah, Khatam al-Anbiya wa Rasul, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. We believe in every single prophet and messenger Allah Almighty sent. We have iman in them. We believe in each and every one of them. We believe in Yawm al-Akhir. We believe that there will be a final day, the last day. وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ, the last day. That last day being the day of judgment. We believe in وَالْقَدْرِ خَيْرِهِ وَشَرِّهِ مِنَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. We believe in destiny. We believe everything has been written. And this is all in the divine knowledge of Allah Almighty. Whether it's good and bad, it is all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we believe in life after death. We believe in the hereafter. We are not like certain religions who believe that once you die, you are reincarnated. Or once you die, like atheists believe that there is no life after death. Once you die, that's it, you're dead. We believe in the day of judgment, and there are logical reasons why we believe in it. And there are textual reasons, textual meaning from the Quran and Sunnah. But when you speak to non-Muslims and they ask you, why do you believe in a day, you know, the day of judgment? You don't quote the Quran and Sunnah to them. Because they don't understand the Quran and Sunnah. What do you quote to them? What do you tell them? You say to them, look, logically think about it. One person kills a million people. Million lives and souls he's taken without any right. No matter how much revenge you take on him, you taking his life for a million lives, it never does justice. Justice will never be done. There will come a day where justice will have to prevail. And that day is the day of judgment. Where me and you ain't no judge, Allah Almighty is the judge. And He is the best of judges. And Allah Almighty will judge me and you. Allah Almighty will question me and you. Allah Almighty will ask me and you what you did in your entire lifetime. And you know, scores and matters will be settled on that day. If man's today can't settle matters and scores, petty street fights and gang warfare, man can't do it here, on that day Allah Almighty will settle everything. Who was right and who was wrong? Witnesses will be brought forward. That day, we believe. But before that day, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed us of signs that will occur. And what is the purpose of a sign? A sign is there to remind you, to direct you, to tell you, to show you. These are a few purposes of a sign. If you can remember, 30, 40 years ago, if you was traveling on the motorway, they didn't have maps in those days. So they had to look for signs. They would look out for M62, this sign, this sign, this sign. I remember once traveling with my uncle, and he said, you know, before TomToms came about, before this the era of tom-toms. Before this, we used to take this route to Birmingham. But now, with the usage and help of tom-toms and signs increasing on the road, on motorways, this is the route that we take. Before, back in the days, 20, 25 years ago, this was the route that we used to take. So we all looked out for signs. We all looked out for signs. What's the purpose of a sign? Sign is there to keep you in check. Sign is there to remind you. Sign is there to keep you in line. We believe in the Day of Judgment, as I mentioned. We also believe in the signs that the Prophet ﷺ told us that will lead up to the Day of Judgment.
SubhanAllah.
Signs that will occur. Signs that have occurred. Minor signs and major signs. Alamatu sughra wal kubra. Minor signs and major signs. These alamat, these signs, Allahu Akbar. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed us of these signs. Informed us of what will happen leading up to the Day of Judgment. A question that somebody may ask you, does Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam have knowledge of when the Day of Judgment will occur? We believe that Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam was given knowledge of everything. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam was given this knowledge by Allah Almighty. Just a point to understand. Allah Almighty gave Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam knowledge of everything. We know that the Quran has knowledge of everything. Everything is mentioned in the Quran. وَلَا رَتْبٍ وَلَا يَابِسٍ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مُبِينٍ. That there is nothing wet or dry except that it is mentioned in the clear book. Yani Al-Quran al-Karim. There is nothing wet or dry except that it is mentioned in the Quran. Yani, i.e. what Allah is saying here, that everything is mentioned in the Quran. And this is further supported by the iman and aqidah of the companions. The companions, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in, they used to say that if we lost the rope of our camel, we could open the Quran and we would find the rope of our camels in it.
SubhanAllah. SubhanAllah.
Yani we would refer and return to the Quran and it would guide us in every matter. It would cure us in every matter. The Quran has everything. And then Allah Almighty in another verse said, Ar-Rahmanu Allama Al-Quran. The Most Merciful taught the Quran. Who did he teach the Quran to? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah Almighty taught the Quran to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. And the Quran possesses knowledge of everything. So when Allah Almighty said the Most Merciful taught the Quran to Nabi alayhi salam, Allah Almighty said the Most Merciful taught Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam everything.
Subhanallah.
If he taught the Quran, he taught everything. Allahu Akbar. A person who describes to you signs leading to the masjid. A person who describes to you how the masjid looks. Describes to you everything about the masjid. Certainly that person must know what that masjid is. Where that masjid is. How to get to that masjid. Bila tashbih wa tamseel, without any comparison. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed me and you of signs about the Day of Judgment. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed me and you about the Day of Judgment itself. What will happen on the Day of Judgment? Where people will be going? Who is in the hellfire? Who is in the gardens of paradise? Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed us all about these things. But Nabi alayhi salam doesn't know when that day is. How can you tell someone about the masjid, how beautiful it is, what it is, describe everything, and then not know what the masjid is? If you know how it looks, then you must know how the masjid is, where the masjid is. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam told us about the Day of Judgment. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam told us about the signs of the Day of Judgment. Nabi alayhi salam told us about what's going to happen on the Day of Judgment. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam knows when the Day of Judgment will occur as well.
SubhanAllah.
They know the signs and they know the day itself. And this is knowledge that is bestowed from Allah Almighty, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is our belief. We believe this. Allahu Akbar. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed the companions about these signs. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed the companions about these signs. One point that comes to mind. People have argued and said, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam doesn't know what will happen on that day. And they quote a hadith that on the Day of Judgment, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam will be standing there and the people will come to them. And they will come to Rasulullah alayhi salam asking, and Hazrat Jibreel will say, Ya Rasulullah, these are not your people, not from your ummah. They say, look, Nabi alayhi salam doesn't know Jibreel is going to tell them. Nabi alayhi salam doesn't know Jibreel is going to tell them. This is a proof that people use to say Nabi alayhi salam doesn't know about the Day of Judgment. My simple question is, who's telling you that this is going to happen in the first place? Who's telling you that this is going to happen on the Day of Judgment? 1400 years ago, the Prophet ﷺ told me and you that Jibreel is going to tell me. And then you say, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam didn't know. Ajeeb. You quote the hadith and you say, the Prophet ﷺ said, Jibreel will say this to me. So Nabi alayhi salam is saying it, but they don't know what you're trying to say. Nabi alayhi salam doesn't know what they're saying. Aliyahu billah. You have to accept Nabi alayhi salam has this knowledge. Allah ta'ala bestowed this knowledge to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is why Allah Almighty in the Quran said, وَعَلَّمَكَ مَا لَمْ تَكُنْ تَعْلَمْ وَكَانَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ عَظِيمًا. وَعَلَّمَكَ مَا لَمْ تَكُنْ تَعْلَمْ. And he taught you what you didn't know. What is that? Everything. If Allah Almighty has said about Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. And he taught Adam the names of everything. كُلَّهَا. He taught Adam the names of everything. What about the one who led Adam alayhi salam in prayer? You see, the Imam is the one who has the most knowledge. If Adam alayhi salam has knowledge of all the names, then why didn't Adam alayhi salam lead the prophets in prayer on the night of Mi'raj? Because Nabi alayhi salam and Adam alayhi salam certainly knew that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam has more knowledge than all the prophets of Allah.
SubhanAllah.
Allah ta'ala taught Adam alayhi salam the names of everything by greater preference and understanding. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam had knowledge of everything more than what Adam alayhi salam had. More than what Adam alayhi salam had. This is the maqam of the knowledge of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And we truly do not understand this great status. For only Allah Almighty knows the grand status that He has bestowed upon His beloved, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi alayhi salam informed the companions about the signs. When we look at the signs of the Day of Judgment, they are broken up into two categories. Minor signs and major signs. Minor signs are broken up into three categories. Signs that have occurred in the past tense, signs that are occurring, and signs that will occur. Minor signs that will occur. And the major signs of the Day of Judgment, as of till date, till now, there is not a single major sign that has occurred. No major sign of the Day of Judgment has occurred. And it has been narrated in the saying of the Prophet ﷺ that there are 10 major signs. And inshallah we will look at them as we have looked through some of the minor signs. We believe that there are minor signs that have occurred. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, one of the first minor signs of the Day of Judgment, one of the signs of the Day of Judgment, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, بُعِثْتُ أَنَا وَالسَّاعَةُ كَهَاتَيْنِ. I and the final hour shall come like this. And they joined their blessed index finger with their middle finger and said, we will come like this. Ya'ni, immediately after me, the day of judgment will follow. Ya'ni, the next thing after me will be the day of judgment. Allahu Akbar. This is a sign. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam leaving this dunya, leaving this world is a sign of the day of judgment. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, leaving this world is a sign that the day of judgment will occur. Another sign that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Quran talks about. اقتربت الساعة وانشق القمر. The final hour is approaching very near. It's coming very close. وانشق القمر. And the moon has split. Scholars have narrated and written that the moon splitting is a sign of the day of judgment. And this sign of the day of judgment, Allah talks about in the Quran. Allah does zikr of this alama of Yawm al-Qiyamah in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, beloved Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, informed that a sign of the day of judgment will be that Baytul Muqaddas, Jerusalem, will be conquered by Muslims. And during the caliphate of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, they conquered Palestine. From Syria, they went to Palestine, and on the mountain of Takbir, where they stood overlooking the blessed city of Jerusalem, it was conquered by Muslims. The Fatah of Jerusalem occurred. Later it was taken over by non-Muslims, and then another conqueror of Jerusalem, of what was Palestine at that time, the great Sultan Salahuddin al-Ayyubi came, and he conquered Jerusalem as well. So Jerusalem being conquered is a sign of the day of judgment. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said that a sign of the day of judgment, the day of judgment will not be established until there will be 30 grand lions. 30 lions. And what will their lie be? Their lie will be that they will claim to be prophets. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam and the Quran have clearly told us, and it is a principal article of our faith, that after the Messenger of Allah Almighty, there will be no prophet of Allah that will come. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam is the seal, is the seal and the finality of prophethood. They are Khatmul Anbiya wal Mursaleen. They are the final prophet and messenger Allah has sent. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, there will be 30 lions who will come after me that will claim to be prophet. And Nabi alayhi salam said in a hadith, and al-aqibu wal-aqibu alladhi la nabiyya ba'di. I am the Aqib, and the Aqib is he, because there will be no prophet after me. There is no prophet that will come after me. So anybody who claims to be a prophet after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a liar. And when you see this, then know the day of judgment is around the corner. This is a sign. And if we look in the last 1400 years, shortly after the Messenger of Allah Almighty left this world, there was a man called Usaymah, who was from Iraq, around that region. He claimed prophethood, al-iyadu billah. He claimed to be a prophet. And he was known as Usaymah al-Kazzab, Usaymah the liar. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq's caliphate, it was mainly occupied and filled with fighting against those people who claim to be prophets of Allah Almighty. People who apostatized, those who were apostates, murtads. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq's time was filled with this. And the leader of the army of the Muslims at that time was none other than Sayyidina Saifullah Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anhu. Sayyidina Khalid radiallahu ta'ala anhu fought against Usaymah Kazzab and defeated him. And then fought against a woman who claimed to be a prophet called Sajda. And like this, from that time, over time, There have come liars who have claimed prophet. And the most modern in our time, who comes from Pakistan, his ideology came around 150 years ago, is Mirza Ghulam Qadiani. And we need to make our Muslims aware of this man and aware of his followers. These are people who believe that this man, Mirza Ghulam Qadiani, this Qadiani man, who was from a village called Qadian, who claimed to be, originally his first claim was that he was the Messiah. He wasn't the Messiah, he was a liar. He wasn't the Messiah, he was a liar. That's what he was. He came in the time of Sayyidi Ala Hazrat Azim al-Barkat Rahmatullah. This man came in the time of Imam of the Ahl Sunnah, Mujaddid of the Deen and Millah, Imam Ahmad Raza Khan, alayhi rahmatu wa ridwan. And he came in the time, and the one who fought against him, the one who challenged him, was the Shanshah of Ghurra, none other than Peer Mahr Ali. Peer Mahr Ali Shah Sahab rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. These were two key men who, through their books, talks, writings, and teachings, defeated Mirza Ghulam Qadian. Allah Hazrat Rahmatullah Alayhi wrote books. Peer Mahr Ali Shah Sahab Rahmatullah Alayhi. Remember, Huzur Peer Mahr Ali Shah Sahab took their ijazat from Khwaja Shamsuddin Sialvi. Khwaja Shamsuddin Sialvi, you know Sial Sharif? Those of you who know Pakistan, Sial Sharif. Khwaja Shamsuddin Sialvi Rahmatullah Alayhi, who was one of the leading sheikhs in the subcontinent at that time. And Alhamdulillah, Thumma Alhamdulillah, myself and Qari Ridwan, we have changed back to this great man, Shamsuddin Sialvi Rahmatullah, through our shiur. My sheikh, Sheikh Muhammad Imdad Hussain Pirzada, their sheikh, Huzur Ziyad Umma, their sheikh, Khwaja Qamruddin Sialvi, their sheikh, Khwaja Qamruddin Sialvi Rahmatullah Alayhi Sheikh. All the way back, Khwaja Qamruddin Sialvi was one of the great grandsons of the great Shamsuddin Sialvi Rahmatullah. And Shamsuddin Sialvi Rahmatullah Alayhi gave ijazat to Peer Mahr Ali Shah Sahab Rahmatullah. Peer Mahr Ali Shah Sahab, such a great astana. Ghurla Sharif, Peer Nasiruddin Nasir Rahmatullah Ta'ala Alayhi, one of their great grandfathers. Allahu Akbar. At the time when the Qadianis arose, we need to make people aware that these people are not Muslims. Those who believe that this man is a prophet of Allah, first he claimed to be a Messiah, he claimed to be Jesus, then he claimed to be Sayyidina Maryam, and he claimed all these things, weird things. He used to, it was a common known fact, drink alcohol. He made haram halal, halal haram. And he was a puppet of the British Empire at that time. This is a known fact. He was a puppet of the British Empire. The British Empire funded him, fueled him to do what? To divide the Muslim Ummah. To divide the Muslim Ummah. And what was one of his main fatwas? That jihad is not fun. Fighting in the way of Allah, sacrificing your life in the way of Allah is not fun. This is what he believed. And he began to spread these fatwa. He started to write these verdicts and people start saying it. Jihad's not fard, jihad's not fard. And this jazba of sacrificing life for the sake of Allah Almighty, this was being taken out of the people of the Muslims' hearts. Why? Because of men like Mirza Ghulam Qadiani, La'natullahi Ali. Men like him. His ideology, Qadiani ideology, Mirza'i ideology, or what they are known in the West as the Ahmadi ideology, is present at this moment in time in our communities. Whether it's Bradford, whether Manchester, whether Birmingham, whether London, it is present. And they are distributing free literature. They are distributing free literature to who? To me and you. But we don't even know. And this is the sad reality. They are in our universities. They have their own societies. They are in all the high positions in the banking system, all of these places. These are people who are destroying Islam. These are people who claim to be Muslims destroying Islam. The West consider them Muslims, but the Muslims don't consider them Muslims. They deny a principle, core article of faith, which is Khatmun Nabuwa, the finality of prophethood. After Nabi alayhi salatu salam, there is no prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When this fitra arose, when Pakistan was being made, there were many of our scholars in Pakistan in the 40s and 50s and in the 60s that were imprisoned. One of those scholars that was imprisoned was Mulana Shafi Uqarbi rahmatullah, who I spoke about shortly before. Mulana Uqarbi sahab rahmatullah alayhi stood against these people. These people imprisoned, or the government at that time imprisoned the scholars. You know how great these scholars were, like Mulana Uqarbi sahab, that within, as soon as they entered into prison, they were imprisoned, within a week, two of their sons passed away. The officer came and said, Uqarbi sahab, you may have heard that your sons have died. All you have to do is apologize, retract your opinion, and we will let you go to the janazah of your sons. Mulana Uqarbi sahab rahmatullah alayhi said, I will never retract my opinion in regards to those who are enemies of Islam. If 1,000 of my sons died in the way of Allah like this, I would let them go.
Subhanallah.
So what if I haven't gone to the janazah? These were the true scholars. These were the true men of Allah. We need to make people aware of this fitna. Our sisters, our brothers in Iman need to be known and be aware of the fitna of the Qadian. These are an enemy from within, trying to destroy Islam, divide Islam. Beware of these people. This is a sign of the Day of Judgment. How does this relate to this topic? It is a sign of the Day of Judgment. And it's a sign that has occurred and is still occurring. People are claiming. These are a few of the signs that have occurred. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed the Sahaba of signs that will occur, minor signs. These are signs that have occurred, and they informed at that time of signs that will occur, and these are signs that I'm going to mention now that are occurring right now. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, alcohol will be on the increase. Sign of the Day of Judgment. The final hour will not be established until alcohol will be on the ink. How true? Look around you. So much alcohol. And what's sad, or what hurts the most? What we should feel the most? You know, our Muslim brothers and sisters are drinking alcohol. They are drinking alcohol. They're getting drunk on Friday night. They're going out mixing Jack Daniels and vodka with Coca-Colas. And they're drinking this stuff. And they think it's allowed. They find it fine. It's like they drink it and it's nothing. It's not your lint or Fanta you're drinking. You're drinking haram. You know, the one who drinks this in this world will be deprived of it in the akhirah. The one who drinks it in this world, he will be distanced from the gardens of Jannah 500 years. The one who drinks it in this world and then he dies in this state will be risen as a drunkard on the day of Qiyamah. The one who drinks it in this world, the curse of Allah and his angels are upon that person. And you look at our Muslims who drink and ask them, do you have any satisfaction in your heart? Are you happy? Do you feel good? And shaitan will make him feel good. But deep down he knows he ain't got no good feeling. Why? Because you're drinking such a cursed thing. What barakah is left in your life? Alcohol will be on the increase. The Prophet ﷺ said, a sign of the Day of Judgment. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam then informed us of more signs that we find narrated in the books of Ahadith. Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Ibn Majah, Abu Dawood, all the great scholars of Hadith narrate these. Nabi Islam said fornication and adultery will be on the increase. Fornication and adultery, married men will be sleeping with women. Married women will be sleeping with men who are not their husbands and not their wives. That's happening today. And Nabi Islam said, you know what's the worst thing? A married Muslim man will sleep with his neighbor's wife. I've heard of stories where this has happened. This is a sign of the Day of Judgment occurring. Hazrat, why are we becoming signs of the Day of Judgment? Why are we becoming signs? Why are we allowing ourselves to become signs of the Day of Judgment? These are signs that we should be fearful of. When we see these signs, then know, Qiyamah is around the corner. The Day of Judgment is around the corner. It is not too far. Do not think that you're going to live for 200, 300 years. Nabi Ali's lifespan will decrease. Nabi Ali Salatu Salam in the hadith said, the average lifespan of my ummah will be 60, 70 years. How true? Very rarely will you hear of a young Muslim who grows to be living till 100, 150, 200 years old. Very rarely. The average lifespan. Allahu Akbar. Look at the knowledge of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Average. They knew the average. You know in maths, how to work out average? You've got to have the quantity, then, I don't know, divide it or something. I didn't do well in averages. But the knowledge of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they knew the average. That must mean Nabi sallam knows how many ummatis there are. And they know how many years they will live. And then Nabi alayhi salam calculated and then knew that the average of my ummati will be 60 to 70 years of age. How much knowledge the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had. Allahu Akbar. So much knowledge. And people then question this knowledge. These are fitnas of our time. A fitna of our time is what? Nabi alayhi salam said, a sign of the Day of Judgment will be that fitnas will increase. Fitras are increasing. Fitras will be widespread. It is a fitra, somebody questions the honor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We live in a time when people apparently, on the open, dishonor the honor of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasallam. Question the honor of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam. Sign of the Day of Judgment. Fitras will increase. This is one of the fitras. This is one of the tests of this time. Nabi alayhi salatu wasallam said a sign, more signs that are occurring at this moment in time. The knowledge will be lifted. Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, how will knowledge be lifted? Nabi Salatu Salam said, knowledge will be lifted by Allah lifting the scholars. The true scholars of the deen, those who possess knowledge of Al-Quran or Sunnah, those who know what Allah and His Rasul have said, who have transmission from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam all the way to their time, through the noble teachers who were connected to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, those people will not be existent amongst us. How true? Today we find jahil, ignorant people who have done a few courses online, who have sat 1 or 2 days and they claim themselves to be big scholars. Ignorance when there is no knowledge, what's the opposite of ilm? Jahil. The opposite of knowledge is ignorance. When knowledge will be lifted, ignorance will be prevalent. Ignorance will be everywhere. And there is so much jahalat out there. You know, if we were to go and delve into this point and think and ponder over it, many of us don't even know how to do wudu properly. That's how ignorant we have become of Islam. We don't even know how to do wudu properly. We don't even know how to pray our salah properly. We become so ignorant and heedless and careless and so weak in our iman that we don't even know how to recite the Quran properly. And reciting the Quran properly is fard. It is an obligation upon you to recite the word of Allah Almighty as it should be recited. As it has been taught by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the companions and all the way till this time when we find the true rightly guided Qura who have understood the true way of reciting the Quran. The ignorant times we live in, months don't even know how to read the Salah properly, how to make wudu properly. It's the time we live in. You know, we become so ignorant, we don't even know how to sit in the house of Allah Almighty properly. We don't even know how to sit in the masjid properly. We don't even know what to do in the house of Allah Almighty. Wallahi, it's sad. Why? Because who's there to teach me and you? We have very few teachers, very few teachers who are actually teaching people these things. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said towards the end of time, there will be big masjids that will be built, but there will be nobody inside them. In this country alone, the central mosques that we have, Jamia masjids, there's nobody inside them. For the purpose of Eid and Jummah, we have built them so big. But day to day, nobody is reading namaz in there. Just a handful of elders will come and read. Sign of the Day of Judgment. Big mosques, decorated, nothing in there. Decorated, nothing in there, nothing happening. House of Allah Almighty is empty. No people there. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, the most beloved place to Allah Almighty is the masjid. Allah loves the masjid more than anything. And Allah hates the town center more than everything. You know, the town centers, these towns that we, our women, we allow for them to go in freedom and roam around in the cars, and our men. In town centers, whether it's Star City in Birmingham, whether it's Arndale in Manchester, whether it's Westfield in London, wherever it may be, big, big shopping centers. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, Allah Almighty doesn't like these places. Why, there's so much fitna there. You know, you become, for a moment, for example, you take 3 years out and change yourself and become a pious Muslim, practicing Muslim. I guarantee you, after 3 years, you go back into those places, you will detest those places. You wouldn't feel good walking in there. You'll be like, so much fitna here. This is not for me, I've changed. But you know, when you're not changed, you thrive off going into shopping centers, looking at women. Seriously, this is what we do. Especially at the age of 18, 19, after college, uni, yeah, let's go town, never know. This mentality our youth are having. So much fitna in those places. We should spend less time in shopping centers and malls and spend more time in the houses of Allah Almighty. You know, the young man who has a connection to the house of Allah Almighty on the Day of Judgment, on the Day of Qiyamah, he will be under the shade of Allah's throne and there will be no shade except his shade. Who? That young man who had a connection to the house of Allah. That when you walked into the house of Allah Almighty, you seen him praying there. I went to one masjid, small place, in Bradford today for Salatul Maghrib. And I seen a 13-year-old young boy on a weekend, dressed in Islamic clothing. And you know what? There were elders there. And he did the adhan. Then he came and stood behind the imam and did the iqamah. And I was amazed. It shocked me that on one hand, look at how many bad, how misguided our youth have become, how lost they've become. Then on the other hand, we have youngsters like this boy, 13-year-old, doing the azan in the house of Allah Almighty. I made dua at that time that, oh Allah, keep him firm on this deen. Oh Allah, you know, this jazbah he has in his heart, this passion he has in his heart, keep it firm in his heart. Allah, let him become a guide for us in the future. 13 years old, he was doing azan. But that's an example for me and you. We should be ashamed when we look at ourselves. 13-year-old, putting us to shame. You know, when a 12-year-old stands up and reads the Quran, and he reads it with tajweed, like the students of Qari Ridwan and other great Qurra, who have truly understood the how to recite the Quran properly. When they stand, you feel ashamed. You should look at yourself and think, man, look at me. I'm 40 years old and I can't read the Quran properly. I'm 22 years old. I think I'm everything and I don't even know how to recite the word of Allah properly. You ain't everything, you're nothing. Until you don't become a man of Allah, you're nothing. You're nothing, you're chasing this dunya. Until you become a man of Allah Almighty. Until the fear of Allah enters your heart. When that comes, then you become a man of Allah. Then you become a real man. Then you become a lion. That's what a lion, a true man of Allah is. A lion of Allah is. Our aim is to become lions of Allah. Our aim is to become men of Allah, servants of Allah. Not servants of the dunya. Not servants of the paper. Not servants of the work hours. Fortunately, the world we live in, we become servants of these things. We should become true servants of Allah Almighty. For there is no greater freedom than in the servitude of Allah. When you're a servant of Allah, you are free. When you're a servant of the dunya, you're caged, man, you're caged. You're in this dunya. This dunya will let you go. This dunya, you chase after it. You're chasing it. Until it throws you into the grave and says, goodbye. Let somebody else chase me now. Where are you? You're 6 feet under. You ain't got nobody there with you. That's the reality of this dunya. That's what this dunya is all about. Become men of Allah. True men of Allah. Who learn the deen. When we look at these 12-year-olds reading the Quran properly, doing the adhan, you should feel good in your heart. You should feel inspiration in your heart. People say, I'm an imam. Wallahi, I was inspired by that kid. He gave me inspiration to become a better person. Even though I'm an imam or whatever you want to call me, whatever you think of me. He inspired me. 13 years old. Wallahi, if I ever have a kid, I wish my kid would do the same thing. There would be nothing that pleases me more than seeing my children recite the adhan at the age of 13 in the house of Allah. Not a 13-year-old kid who knows how to play Call of Duty, or a 13-year-old kid who knows how to play GTA 5. No, that doesn't make me happy. Oh, he's passed his GCSEs and he's so learned in the dunya. You should be pleased and proud when your child becomes a man of Allah. When he knows what's halal and what's haram. He knows how to connect to Allah Almighty. That is what should please you. You should be happy when you see that. If you don't see that, you should work towards him becoming that. That's how our parents should be thinking. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said that towards the end of time, you will find that men will dress like women and women will dress like men. We live in that time now where our attire, our appearance is not Islamic no more. You see our brothers and sisters today, and you put, for example, a Sikh man or woman, you couldn't tell the difference between the two. Seriously, you couldn't. You'd think they're the same. Most probably because the skin color is the same, because they're from India-Pakistan region, the subcontinent. But look at that. You can't tell the difference between a Sikh man and a Muslim man. A Sikh woman and a Muslim woman. Why? You know, this is why when people say, oh, wearing juba and wearing salwar kameez and wearing a turban and wearing these things are not major, Imam sahab. It does become major when you know, when you want to differentiate. This is what differentiates. This is what lets you know who you are. What you are. We've come and lived in this country and we've adopted these things. We should go back to what Islam is teaching me and you. What does Islam say? We should, when somebody looks at us, we straight away think, I know he's a Muslim. I know he's a Muslim. You know why? This is a sign of a Muslim. Sign of a Muslim is he grows his beard, trims his moustache. Keeps his moustache small. Keeps it small. Sign of a Muslim is he wears a turban on his head. And not a turban like the Sikhs wear a turban. You see, then you might say, a Sikh man wears a turban, Muslims wear a turban. They grow beard, you grow beard. Their moustache are very big. Ours aren't that big. They shouldn't be that big. They don't take no hair off. Our deen teaches us to take all our hair off. In those areas, we take our hair. This is what Islam teaches us. So there is a difference. And you can tell immediately. Immediately you can tell when you see a Muslim. There are signs that come from him. The first thing, without him speaking, without you speaking, I can tell that brother's a Muslim. I can tell. Right now, if you looked at somebody looked at you, could they tell you're a Muslim? Really? With all these brands on ourselves. I don't know, Adidas. All these things. Could they tell we're Muslims, really? We shave our beard, yet shaving what is the lion's mane? Take the lion's mane off him. Is there any, would you feel scared of a lion? Does he have ro'ab on his face? Have you ever stood in front of a lion? I had the honor of standing in front of a lion. When I went to South Africa, I went safari. Oh, that was 2 hours, just about 2 hours out. So we went and we stood in front of a lion. And we've seen a lion. And you know, a lion is a scary animal. A lion is an animal that has no fear. It truly is the king of the jungle, as they say. This is why, you know, the great soldiers of Islam are described as lions of Allah. It's a simile. Metaphorically speaking, he, so-and-so, he's brave like a lion. A lion is known for its bravery and its courage. You know, when you look at a lion, have you ever analyzed a lion's face? Have you noticed? A lion's eyes, around his, you know, eyelash, it has like a surma on there. Even if you take your phones out and look at it, you'll find surma on a lion's eyes. Allahu Akbar. Then, you see it has whiskers, very small touch. And it has a fist long beard. See, our men should look like lions. Not like women, like lions. A lion has a beard and surma. All a lion needs now is a turban. When that lion has a turban on his head, wallahi, that's a great lion of Allah. See, we need to look like lions. You know what have we become? We don't look like lions no more. We need to look like lions. Look like a lion. Wear surma in your eyes. Nabi alayhi salam used to, it's a sunnah to wear surma in your eyes. I don't mean eyeliner. Don't be going into no, what do you call them, boots. And buying some eyeliner. No. Get some surma, which is sunnah. Put it in your eye on the day of Jum'ah. Wear a turban, white colored. And then, grow your beard. Islam. Allah, you see him and you think there's a lion there. Lions of Allah are walking. Men of Allah Almighty, this is how we should look. And what have we become? Lining our beards, grading our beards, zigzagging our beards. Come on. We should stick to the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is what we should do. And we shouldn't be ashamed. Why are we ashamed? See, only, you know, even the British, if you look at the monarchs, the kings, King Henry had a beard. King Henry VIII had a beard. Even the British, the West knew that a sign of manhood was a beard. And they had fist-long beards. They had big beards. Even the Jewish Muslim, the Jewish community, the Jewish, they have beards, the Orthodox ones. Orthodox Christians have beards. You know, this beard is not just the sunnah of Nabi alayhi salam. It is a practice of all the prophets of Allah Almighty. They all have beards. It's a sign of man. Allahu Akbar, lengthen your beard, let him grow. But the beard is not everything, keep that in mind as well. You know, you see mans with big beards, but they're looking in their hearts. You need to, you know, they say, people say, my beard's in my heart. Your beard is in your heart. I didn't know it, the heart grew hair. You must have a hairy heart then. If you've got a beard on your heart, you must have a hairy heart. Wow. Let that hair now grow on your face as well. How? He says, oh, Imam Sahib, it doesn't grow. Well, if you break your razor, it might grow. If you break the Gillette Mark 3, it'll grow. Guarantee it will grow. Leave it for a few weeks. You watch how it grows. Then go to the barber and say, you know what, my beard's growing. Smarten it. Make it look clean. You find some Muslims whose beards are all over the place. They need to look after their beards. One man came to Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam and his beard was everywhere. Clothes were everywhere. Nabi alayhi salam didn't look at it. Ya Rasulullah didn't look at it. Nabi alayhi salam said, look, clean. The sign of a Muslim, he looks clean. People should be attracted to a Muslim. They should smell fragrant. Look beautiful. Adorned in the sunnah. Allahu Akbar. This is how we should be today. And this excuse, oh Imam Sahib, not ready to grow the beard. That's the biggest satanic excuse you can use. You know why? You know why you say that? You said that because you know if you grow the beard, you're going to stop messing around. And you don't want to stop messing around. So you think, you know what? I'm not going to, yep, my beard's fine. Without a beard, I can chill. Once I have a beard, then there's response. Good. Put the beard on, maybe you become more responsive. Start wearing a turban, maybe you might realize. Might stop you from a load of things. It's true, isn't it? Big excuse youth used to me. Say, Imam Sahab, I'm not ready for the beard. Not ready, it's not time. They say, why? I can't do it, Imam Sahab. Not yet. Let me get married, maybe. When you let me get married, then I'll grow a beard. You know, then I've got my wife, Muhammad Wali. Allahu Akbar. So we find the right people. This is very important that we have the sunnah on our face. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed us that there will be big mosques and nobody inside them, and dunya talk will be happening in the house of Allah. It's a sign of the day of judgment. This sign is prevalent today. It's present in our time. You go into the house of Allah, you find old men sitting there talking about Pakistani politics. Talking about Ashes cricket. Or did you see him last night? Or Pakistan and India, what happened? Talking about the dunya in the house of Allah. This is the house of Allah Almighty. In this place, there should be just the talk of the deen. Or silence. Why? Respect for the house of Allah. What's happening in our time? So bad. We find people coming in here and talking about the dunya. Talking about the world. The politics, what's happening in the world. The house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be left only to talk about the deen and encouragement for the deen. This is a sign of the day of judgment that dunya will be spoken about in the house of Allah. These are a few signs that are occurring. We see present in our time. Lack of knowledge. Ignorance will prevail. Adultery will be on the increase. Alcohol will be on the increase. Backbiting and lying will be on the increase. Men will dress like women and women will dress like men. Big masjids and nobody inside them. Dunya talk will happen in the house of Allah Almighty. People will be involved in fraud and haram. Common. I don't even need to talk about that. We all know what's happening there. Nabi Salatu Wasalam said that sinful, ignorant people will be made leaders of nations. They will be made leaders of governments. Today, the most giant people, ignorant people, are leading countries, are heads of states, have no knowledge, know nothing, but now they are leaders of our nation. In the state of Pakistan, our own country. Jahil, ignorant people leading the world. Leading our country, and look where it's going. We need men of knowledge, men of education, to take control and charge. And that knowledge, which is knowledge of Quran and Sunnah. They are the true leaders, are those who know what Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have said. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed us that there will be a lot of wealth, but nobody will give zakah. How many of our people, in their bank balances, in their savings accounts, will have thousands of pounds stashed away? They will put this committee and all this into it. You know what? All this money, no zakah. End of the year, they won't even calculate. This is a right of the poor, it's a fard, an obligation. We have neglected this fardiyah, this obligation, to the extent that today some of the poorest people in the world are Muslims. 75% of the world's refugees are Muslim. 75% of the world's refugees. I guarantee you, and write this down even in stone if you have to, guarantee you, if all the Muslims in the world, if there was a system in place which collected zakat money and then distributed to the poor, I guarantee you there will be no poverty left in this world. All the Muslims, and there are 1.5 billion approximately Muslims around the world, those who reach the level that zakat is fard on them. And if we just look at the Arabs, you know, Forbes has a list of the rich people. These Arabs, they They're too rich that they're not even on the list. That's how much petrol dollar they have. So much money, so much dollars. If they gave zakat, every Arab prince who was loaded with billions gave 2.5% of that. Say if that was a trillion, 250 million, for example. I'm telling you, and that was given to Africa, there will be no poverty left in Africa. Guaranteed. You know, the Western society taxes you 20%. And we say the West is so great, the West is so great with the society and mentality. You know what my understanding is? Islam, 1400 years ago was 2.5%. Now it's 2.5%. Islam says just give 2.5%. The tax you 2.5% for the poor. Zakat is a form of, you can understand it like, it's like a tax. 2.5%, that's it. And who? Those who have the money. If you're poor, you don't give zakat. It's not fard on you. When you reach that level, then it's fard on you. Now 2.5%. There's no value added tax, no increasement in it, no interest rate, nothing. Look how beautiful Islam is. If we truly understood Islam and applied it, if we applied Islam in modern world, there would be no wars, guaranteed. If we applied Islam in the modern world, there would be no besharmi, no behayai. There would not be no immorality. If we implied Islam in the modern world, humans will have a high standard of character. Their level of morality will be at its peak. Humans will actually be like humans. We will become slaves of Allah Almighty if Islam was truly applied in the world. If Islam was truly understood by Muslims. See, people, even Muslims have misunderstood Islam. They have distorted the teachings of Islam. They have manipulated for their own desires. Go back to what Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said and apply that. And if this was applied, I guarantee you, there would be no poverty left in this world. There would be no poverty left in this world. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said towards the end of time, murder, killing will be on increase. Just because we don't hear of the murders that happen in this country on a daily basis, doesn't mean murders don't occur here. If you was to go and study the statistics, and I've not looked into this, though I should have before I came, about the rate of murders, the number of murders that occurs in UK are not just gun crime or any kind of murder. And they have these figures, because when these murders are taken to court, it is all recorded. There are organizations and data banks out there who have this knowledge. And what's happening in America, how many murders? People taking innocent lives without any reason. No reason to take this life. Innocent life is taken. Towards the end of time, Nabi Salam said, murder will be on the increase. Killings. Just in the last 100 years, how many hundreds of millions of humans have been killed in the world wars? In the wars around the world. Before this, what was that? In the time of the Prophet ﷺ, people say Islam is a barbaric religion. Misconception. This is a false lie. Tell me how many people, soldiers that were killed in war in the time of the Prophet ﷺ. It totals to around, in the life of Rasulullah ﷺ, about 500. In Nabi ﷺ's life. 500 to the 100 million. Tell me who's more barbaric? Who's more extreme? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there are strict laws of warfare that Islam has set up. Islam is a way of life in every aspect. If you truly apply Islam in your life, then truly you have a way of life. But if you don't apply Islam in your life, then you have no way of life. You're a vigilante. You just do what you want to do, which is what, unfortunately, our Muslims are becoming, or have become. By name Muslim, by action, no way of life. Unfortunately, this is what our state has become. Allah Ta'ala guide each and every one of us. Amen. These are a few signs, minor signs that have occurred. There are minor signs that will occur. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed us of future minor signs that will occur. For example, the number of men will decrease and the number of women will increase. That for every one man there will be 50 women. That will be the ratio. 1 to 50. And it's when the number of men are decreasing. Look, in China, there's a law that every family is only allowed one child. And China has the world's largest, is the largest populated country in the world, with around 1.5 billion people that just live in China. And in total, there are around 7 billion humans in the world. 1.5 billion are in China. Well, that's a serious figure. And if you look at the land of China, the size of it, the largest country in the world that has, by size, is Russia. China is not the largest, but it has such a large population. Large population that now there's a law to cut the number of children so that the population doesn't grow. 1.5 million just in China. Allahu Akbar. And Nabi alayhi salam said that towards the end of time, for every one man there will be 50 women. It's a sign. And we're coming towards that time, there are more women that we are seeing than men. More women that we are seeing than men, and it's a sign that will occur. It's going to increase, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said that the Muslims will conquer Rome. This is yet to occur. There will be the conquest of Rome. Rome is where? Europe. The conquest of Europe yet to occur. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed us. Another minor sign of the Day of Judgment that we possibly have been sitting to hear about is the coming of Imam Mahdi. Imam Mahdi alayhi salam is one of the signs of the Day of Judgment when he will arrive. Imam Mahdi's name is Muhammad ibn Abdullah. His name will be Muhammad, the son of Abdullah. His father's name will be Abdullah, his mother's name will be Amina. And Imam Mahdi will be a descendant from the children of Sayyidah Fatima Zahra radiallahu ta'ala anha. He's a Sayyid. He will be from the children of Sayyidah Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha. He will be a noble Imam that will come to guide the people. Mahdi meaning the guide. He is the Imam that will guide. He will come at a time in the world when there will be so many tests, so much trials and tribulations in the world. When Imam Mahdi will be born, he will go from Medina Munawwara to Makkah Mukarram. And at the age of 40 years, during the period where he will be doing the tawaf around the Kaaba, a voice will come up and say, Mahdi has arrived, the Mahdi has come. And then people will recognize Imam Mahdi alayhi salam. And Imam Mahdi alayhi salam will have a stature in his speech, will have a large forehead, and the nose will be very perfect. And he will be of medium height. And Imam Mahdi alayhi salam will be a man who, when people will know who he is, when the announcement will be made, he will gather all the Muslims together. The Muslims will unite under Imam Mahdi. Imam Mahdi will become the Khalifa of the Muslims. He will rule the Muslims. At the age of 40, this will occur. Imam Mahdi alayhi salam, there will be a war between Christians and Muslims that will occur, a major war. And that army of the Muslims will be led by Imam Mahdi. The Muslims will be victorious in this battle. The Muslims will win that war. And this war will take place in Syria. Syria today, if we was to contextualize it, Just as Palestine is a hot topic for people, it's a major issue for the Jews. Palestine is a major, major issue. This is where the Messiah will come. This is where the false Antichrist, the Dajjal, will arrive. And this land of Palestine is of great significance to the Jews. This is why they are preoccupied and taking occupation and taking land of the Muslims so that they can prepare for the arrival of the Dajjal. Syria plays a great significance as well. And we are seeing now how Syria is becoming more and more apparent in the news. How people are knowing more about Syria. 5 years ago, nobody knew what Syria was. Now everyone knows Syria because of the civil war there. The war will take place in Syria. There will be a famine in the world that will be for 3 years. Then Constantine, Istanbul will be conquered. It will be in the hand of Muslims. And the spoils of that war, you know, when you win a battle, there are spoils left over. This will be shared and distributed amongst the Mu'mins, the believers. And then the Dajjal will come out. Imam Mahdi alayhi salam will come before the Dajjal. When the Dajjal will arrive, the Dajjal, Nabi alayhi salam described the Dajjal. They described the features of the Dajjal. One question before we look at the Dajjal. We don't know if Imam Mahdi is here or not. Only Allah has this knowledge. There are certain people who believe Imam Mahdi is here now. And he is the 12th Imam for them. But today, Imam Mahdi, if he's here now, then the hadith of the Prophet said at the age of 40 years, we'll do Ilan. And for how many years have they been saying he's here? Then they clearly go against that hadith. So we don't follow the ideology of these people, we follow the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When Imam Mahdi will come, there will be an ilan. And he will come at a time when there will be fitna in the world. Testing time. Imam Mahdi will come as a shining light, as a guide for the people to guide them out of darkness into light. When Imam Mahdi alayhi salam will come, thereafter the Dajjal will appear. The description of the Dajjal has been mentioned. That the Dajjal will be blind from the right eye. And this right eye will be drooping like a grape. And he will only see from his left eye. And he will claim to be the Messiah. And he will claim to be God. Remember, the Dajjal is a creation of Allah. That Allah has created to test the people. The Dajjal is one eye. And Allah Almighty is nothing like this. So the Dajjal can't be God. He's not God. Though that will be his claim. And written between his two eyes will be Kafa and Ra. And he will have curly hair. And he will have a nose that is slightly bent. And the Dajjal, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, said that every Prophet of Allah Almighty, informed the nation about the Dajjal and the test of the Dajjal. And Nabi alayhi salam said, the Dajjal will be the severest test on my ummah. And the greatest army that will be formed will be the army that will fight the Dajjal. They will be the greatest Muslims of that time. We make dua that if it's in our time, then Allah knows best. And if not in our time, our children or our great-grandchildren's time, or our great-great-grandchildren, whenever it is, that our children are in that Muslim army. That they are soldiers in that army. You know what the condition is? You've got to start Islam now in your houses. Then you've got to teach this Islam to your children and make them into good Muslims. And then make sure that your children teach their children proper Islam. And pure, true Islam is taught to all of them until the arrival of the Dajjal. Then when the call by Imam Mahdi will come, that let the Muslim army unite, let the Muslims gather, then inshallah our children will be there to fight against the jahl.
Subhanallah.
Nabi said they will be the greatest army. They will be the greatest army that will fight. Nabi said that the jahl, when he will arrive, he will have no children, he will have a big body. Dajjal at this moment in time, according to the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, is present. Where he exactly is, we don't know. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam has informed the hadith of Tamim al-Dari. Nabi alayhi salam one day stood up on the minbar and narrated this story. He said, Tamim Dari was a Christian who accepted Islam, was riding with 30 men on a ship, and the ship wrecked onto an island. And when they arrived on this island, they found that there was an animal in front of them. And they described this animal had hair, or this creature had hair from head to toe, covered in hair. And he called himself Jasasa. And Jasasa means spy. And this animal, or this creature, they were amazed to see, Tamim al-Dari was amazed to see him. And he said, I will show you something more amazing. And he took them to the cave. He took them through the island into a cave. And in that cave, there was chained up the jar. And the jar was chained up like this. Legs were chained, arms were chained. And the jar asked questions from Tamim Dari about the state of the world at that time. Asked them about future things. And then Tamim Dari, who went back onto this ship and came to Medina Munawwara, narrated this to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Nabi alayhi salam narrated this to the companions and warned them about the time when the Dajjal will come. What will the Dajjal do? How long will the Dajjal come for? The Dajjal will come for 40 days. His first day will be like a month, a year. His second day will be like a month. His third day will be like a week, and every other day will be like a normal day. What this is highlighting is the Dajjal will cover a vast amount of land in a short space of time. And he will go from east till west. And Nabi alayhi salam described that he will use an animal that will have ears larger than, will have a donkey or ears that will have such large ears. An animal that will have large ears. And he will cover a short space of large amount of land in a short space of time. He will go to every city, every place, and he will ask them, who is your Lord? And those who are weak in Iman, those who are not Muslims, he'll say, you are. Because he will show them miracles. He will say, come, where do you want to go? He'll show them water in his right hand and fire in his left hand. And anyone who chose the water, in essence and reality, he went to the fire. And anyone who chose the fire, in essence and reality, went to the water. And Nabi alayhi salam said, the first person that he will question, he will chop him into half and kill him. He will chop that individual into half and kill him and say, who is your Lord? He will say, Rabbi Allah, I believe in Allah. And the Dajjal will kill him. And remember, the Dajjal is a creation of Allah. He's a test upon the people. And Allah has given him powers of miracle, that he is able to do these things to test the people. When the Dajjal will cover this land, there are two places in the world that he will not be allowed to enter, that will be forbidden for him. One will be Makkah Mukarramah, and one will be the city of Rasulullah SAW, Medina Munawwara. The Dajjal will not enter this city. The Dajjal will not enter this city. And the Mu'minun will take refuge in this city. The believers will stay in the city of Medina Munawwara. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, indeed Iman runs to Medina Munawwara like a snake runs to its home. The Iman runs to Medina Munawwara. Yani, the house of Iman, the place of Iman is the city of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is where Iman is, at the city of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said that there will be seven doors guarded by angels and the Dajjal will not be allowed to enter. At that time, there will be 70,000 so-called Muslims that will follow the Dajjal. 70,000 munafiqs, hypocrites, that will sell out and follow Dajjal. That will sell out and follow Dajjal. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam then mentioned and continued to mention that anybody that will be brought in front of him and that denies him, he will kill him. And he will control the skies and the earth. He will control these things to test the people, to make them think that he is God. Those who are weak, then they will fall into this trap. And he will kill them, destroy them. Dajjal will, his army will come. His army will consist of 70,000 Jews who will be wearing hoods on their head. And they will all gather in a place called Iran. Country called Iran, called Asfahan. A place will call Asfahan. They will gather there. And Dajjal will arrive in Jordan and meet his army. When Dajjal will meet his army, he will prepare to fight the Muslims. The Muslims will be performing the Salah in city of the Umayyad Masjid, Masjid Umawi, in Damascus. At that time of Fajr, Imam Mahdi will be leading. And Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, who is alive and present in the heaven, who is the true Messiah, not the false Messiah. The true Messiah will return. Remember, in religious historical context, if we take this into consideration, the Jews believe that Isa alayhi salam was killed on the cross. And the Muslims believe Isa alayhi salam was lifted to the heaven. So when the Jews say the Messiah will return, they interpret this as the Dajjal. And when Muslims say the Messiah will return, we have interpreted this as Sayyidina Isa al-Masih, Isa ibn Maryam alayhi wasalam. This is who will return. Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam will return with two angels. They will descend on the eastern minaret of the masjid in Damascus, Umayyad Masjid, Umayyad Masjid. And then he will come to Sayyidina Imam Mahdi will be there at that time. And Imam Mahdi will lead the Muslims in prayer. And then Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam and the Muslim army will go out to fight the Dajjal. And this will be the greatest army that has ever fought. And when they will go, they will find the Dajjal in modern day Israel, which is our Palestine. They will find him there. And the Dajjal will be killed by Isa alayhi salam. And when Isa alayhi salam will see the Dajjal and the Dajjal will see him, he will begin to melt. He will begin to tremble. And he will be killed in a place called Lud. Lud is not too far from the airport in Tel Aviv. I am going to Palestine on the 20th of December this month. I've been to that place called Lud. There is a well there. It is marked. It is at that place that the Dajjal will be killed by Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam. But Isa alayhi salam will kill him and destroy the Dajjal. The Jews will run. They will hide behind stones, rocks and trees. And every rock and stone will say, "A Muslim, there is a Jew behind me, kill him. A Muslim, there is a Jew behind me, kill him." The stones and trees will speak up. Allahu Akbar. Then, at that time, the Sayyidina Imam Mahdi alayhi salam, when they've defeated them, Isa alayhi salam will become the leader of the world. Isa alayhi salam will become the leader of the world. And they will be on the world for 40 years. 40 plus years, 40 or so years. They will get married and have children. And they will break every cross and kill every swine. And they will establish the Sharia of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Isa alayhi salam will return, not as a prophet of Allah Almighty, but as an ummati of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Isa alayhi salam will leave this world. At that time when they will rule, there will be prosperity, greenery. There will be aman and sakoon, peace and tranquility in the world at that time. Isa alayhi salam and Dajjal are major signs of the Day of Judgment. During the time of Isa alayhi salam, Ya'juj and Ma'juj will arrive. Ya'juj and Ma'juj are an army that Sayyidina Zulqarnain alayhi salam banished and put into an area where that is, Allah knows best. Some people say behind the Great Wall of China. Others say different interpretations have been done. But Allah knows best. As to where the Ya'juj and Ma'juj are. Ya'juj and Ma'juj, every night, they dig at this wall. And when they go to sleep, they say, you know, tomorrow when we wake up, this wall will be as it is and we will destroy it. When they wake up, they find that the wall is rebuilt high again. And then, the time when they will be given permission by Allah to leave, and they are short in size, they will have large ears that when they sleep, it will cover their face. And they will have very small eyes. And they will have bow and arrow. And with the bow and arrow, when they will be freed from this prison cell, you can understand it to be, when they're freed from this seclusion that they are in at this moment in time, that night they will say, you know, inshallah, if Allah wills, tomorrow we will be free. When they wake up in the morning, they will find that the wall is where they left it. They will find the wall is where they left it. Then what will happen is they will come out and cause havoc in the dunya. They will cause havoc in the dunya, kill the people. The Muslim army will defeat them. And they will go around and they will fire arrows in the sky. They will fire arrows in the sky and they will say, look how great we are. And those arrows will return with blood on them and say, look, we've killed Allah as well. And iyaz billah, they will say, we've killed Allah, look, there's blood coming from the sky. This is a sign we've killed Allah. Allah Almighty will destroy them. Thereafter, all the other major signs will follow. Signs such as Dabatul Ard. Allah talks about this sign in the Quran. The beast of the earth that will arise between the mountain of Safa and Marwa. Then the Dukhan. There's a full entire surah in the Quran on this. The smoke. When the smoke will come over the people. And this beast, what will he do? The beast will mark the heads, the foreheads of the believers. And mark those who are non-believers. And he will have the ring of Sulaiman alayhi salam. And he will have the staff of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam. And he will use them to mark their heads, stamp their heads or mark their foreheads. Who is a believer, who is not a believer. Then there will be three major earthquakes that will occur. One in the east, one in the west, and one in the Middle East. And after these major earthquakes, Nabi alayhi salam said there will be a black African who will go to the Kaaba and destroy the Kaaba brick by brick. And at that time, there will be so much fitna in the world. No iman left in the world. That there will be nobody to do the zikr of Allah Ta'ala. There will be nobody left to do the zikr of Allah Almighty. When this occurs and happens, then Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, then know the day of judgment will be established. The day of judgment itself, these were the major signs. The day of judgment itself, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed us about the signs. In certain narrations, Nabi alayhi salam informed that the day of judgment will be established on a Friday. This is why every animal and jinn fears a Friday. Why? Because they know that the day of Qiyamah will be established. The trumpet will be blown on a Friday. This trumpet that will be blown by one of the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sayyidina Israel alayhi salam. Sayyidina Israfil alayhi salam. They will blow this angel. This angel will blow this trumpet. This angel was created by Allah Almighty, and ever since it's been created, is waiting for Allah's permission to blow this trumpet. When this trumpet will be blown, such will be the power of the sound of this trumpet that it will destroy everything. All the creation of Allah will be destroyed. Angels, humans, animals, universe, everything Allah has created will be destroyed. Then 40 years later, this now angel will be created by Allah and he will blow the trumpet a second time. وَنُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ. Second time. And the second time he will blow, Allah will resurrect and recreate everything. And everyone will be raised on a land. And it's described, some say, the land of Arafat. Clear land. And they will be risen on this day. The first to rise from the grave will be none other than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from their blessed grave. First to arrive. When Nabi alayhi salam will rise from the blessed grave, 70,000 angels will shroud him. 70,000 angels will surround him. And Nabi alayhi salam said, you know, Abu Bakr and Umar, they will be my right hand and in my left hand on that day. They will be with Rasulullah salam on that day. Thereafter, the people of Baqi will be rising. The people of Jannatul Baqi, those who are buried in the graveyard of Baqi in Medina Munawwar. Then every human, how many humans, from the time of Adam and Islam till now, at this moment in time, there are 7 billion. Statistics said 100 years ago, there were around 3 billion. Before that, 1 billion. Yani so many humans will all be resurrected. All will arise. When they will rise from their grave, they will be in the state of nakedness. Those who are pious servants of Allah Almighty, Allah will shroud them and clothe. They will be clothed on that day. There will be some men who will be walking, some who will be crawling, and some will be dragged on their faces. They'll be walking on their face. Allahu Akbar. Elisha said, Ya Rasulullah, how will they walk on their face? Nabi alayhi salam said, you know how Allah makes them walk on their feet, He can also make them walk on their face. Allah will make these people walk on their face. Some people will walk, and they will be in a state of drunkenness. Others, the description will be like swine and monkeys. There will be some whose tongues will be hanging out. There will be some whose stomachs will be very large, who used to eat interest money. Nabi alayhi salam described all these things. They will all gather. Nabi alayhi salam described this day to be longer than 50,000 years. One day longer than 50,000 years. For who? For those who are sinners. For those who are bad. But those who are true believers of Allah Almighty, had iman in Allah Almighty, it will be like 4 units of prayer. And when the day will begin, they will say, Ya Allah, is that it? So quickly this day has gone by. Yani the believers, for them it will be an easy ride. Those who don't believe, those who commit sins, for them it will be very difficult. Nabi alayhi salam described that on that day, the sun will be a mile or mile and a half above the head. And people will be drowning in their sweat. Some people's sweat will be coming up to their ankles. Others, their sweat will be coming up to their knees. Others will be into their hips. And for others, the sweat will be coming up to their... Some will be drowning in entire sweat. People will be running around on that day, asking for each other's help. And on that day, Allah in the Quran said, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. On that day, no money, no children, nobody can help you, except the one who comes with a clean heart. Except the one who comes with a pure heart. Except the one who comes with a sincere heart. On that day, nothing can help man, other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Other than his good deeds. Other than connection to the good people. الْأَخِلَّاءُ يَوْمَعِذٍ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُوٌ إِلَّا الْمُتَّقُونَ. On that day, friends will be enemies of friends. Boys will be enemies of boys. Except those who are pious. Those whose friends were good. Those whose friends told them to be guided. Those who took them to the house of Allah Almighty. Those who showed them the true way. They will be friends and help us on that day. On that day, nothing can help me and you, except the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On that day when man will be in this state of frenzy, man will be blind running around. On that day Nabi alayhi salam said, there will be some people that will be running around like ants. Running around like ants. You know why? In the dunya they thought they were big timers. In the dunya they walked around arrogant. They walked around with takabbur and akar. And on that day Allah Almighty will make them so small that they will be running around people's feet hoping that nobody would trample upon them. In the dunya they thought they were big, but on the akhirah there will be nothing for them. Such arrogant, boastful people, this will be their state. When people will be in this hal, in this surah, this will be the situation at that time. People will be running around. And people will be saying, Ya Allah, begin the day of Qiyamah. Till now, Qiyamah hasn't begun. Till now, questioning hasn't occurred. This is just a test for those people. You know, Nabi alayhi salam said that on that day when the throne of Allah will come and the shade of that throne of the majesty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be there. Allahu Akbar. There will be 7 groups of people who will be under that shade. Nabi alayhi salam said, you know, that man, that boy, that a woman tempted him, and she said, I fear Allah. He said, I fear Allah. They will be under the shade of that tree. You know, that person who gave charity, that his left hand didn't know what his right hand was giving, that person will be under the shade of Allah's throne. You know, that person, that child, that man, who had a connection to the house of Allah Almighty, on that day, he will be under the shade of Allah's throne. You know, the one who had connection to Allah's deen, he will be connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And on that day, he will be under the shade of Allah's throne. The one who recited abundant salutations on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on that day, that person will be under the shade of Allah's throne, when there will be no shade except the shade of his throne. The one who sent salawat on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When this will be the situation, people will be running around asking for one another's help. They will all, people will say, let's go to the chosen people on that day. The men of Allah Almighty. So let's go to our father Adam alayhi salam. When they will go to Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, said, Ya Aba al-Bashar, O father of human, you are the first human Allah has created. Allah blew his ruh inside you. Allah Almighty commanded the angels to prostrate before you. Intercede to Allah Almighty. Ask Allah Ta'ala, do shafa'at for us today. That Allah Ta'ala begins the day of judgment and questions us. And that the test of this day ends. Adam alayhi salam will say, not today Allah is angry with me. I ate from the forbidden tree. Not today Allah is angry with me. Idhabu ila ghayri. Go to somebody else other than me. Go to Ibrahim alayhi salam. Go to Nuh alayhi salam. The entire makhluk of Allah, entire creation of Allah, all the humans will go to who? Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam. When they will arrive at Sayyidina Nuh, they will say, O Nuh of Allah, O Nuh Allah, O Nuh, O the one who is Najirullah, the one who Allah Almighty rescued, O one who Allah has rescued, when people, when he sent the tufan, O one that Allah Almighty has chosen from the prophets, intercede for us on this day. So not today, can't do it today, Allah is angry with me, go to other than me. He will arrive at Ibrahim alayhi salam and said, Ibrahim, you are Khalilur Rahman, you are the best friend of Allah Almighty. Allah Almighty chose you over his servant. You are the father of all the prophets. O Ibrahim alayhi salam, intercede for us today. Ibrahim alayhi salam said, Idhabu ila ghayri. Allah is angry with me today. Go to somebody else. Then they will arrive. One by one, they will go to each and every prophet of Allah Almighty until they come to Sayyidina Musa, Kalimullah alayhi salam. When they will arrive at Kalimullah alayhi salam, the one who spoke to Allah Almighty, they say, O Musa, you spoke to Allah directly. Allah chose your nation over all nations. Allah gave you the Torah. Intercede for us today. Ask Allah to help us today. Ask Allah Almighty to begin the day of Qiyamah today. And Allah Almighty will say, and as Musa alayhi salam will say at that time, Allah is angry with me today. Ithabu ila Isa. Go to Isa alayhi salam. Ask Isa alayhi salam about what's going to happen. I can't help you today. Allahu Akbar, when they will arrive. I say to Isa alayhi salam, him say, Ya Ruhullah, O the one who Allah blew his spirit into, the one who has no father, whose mother was a pure virgin, the one who Allah has given the Bible to, the one who Allah has chosen, the one who Allah Almighty lifted to the heavens. Allahu Akbar. O Isa alayhi salam, O one who Allah has chosen, Ruhullah, intercede for us today. So Allah is angry with me today. Allah is angry with me today. Izhabu ila Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Go to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Go to the leader of all the prophets, he's going to help you today. On that day, we will have no option but to go to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When we will arrive to Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam. And all the creation will say, Ya Habiballah, Ya Rasulullah. You are Allah's beloved. Allah chose you over all his prophets. You led them all in prayer. And we begin to praise the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Intercede for us today. Ask Allah to bring Qiyamah today. Do shafa'at. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam will say, Ana laha, ana laha. That this shafa'at, this maqam, this status, this is only for me. This is only for me. Only I can do this today. On a day when Allah Almighty is so angry, only the beloved can go to the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Nare takbir!
Allahu Akbar!
Nare risalah!
Ya Rasulullah!
Nare hadri!
Ya Ali!
On that day, we will arrive to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam will go before Allah Almighty and bow down in prostration. Nabi alayhi salam will remain in sujood for the period of 1 month. And then Allah Almighty will say, Irfa ra'saka ya Muhammad. O most praised one, O most praised one, raise your blessed head. Son, ask. Yusma, you will be heard. Qul, speak. Speak and you will be heard. Ask, tu'ta, you will be given. Fashfa, fatushafa, intercede, and your intercession will be accepted. Nabi alayhi salam will say, they have come. Ya Allah, begin the question. And it is then that the scales will be brought forward. It is then that the books will be given to man. It is then when me and you will be questioned. It is then we will have to stand before Allah. One by one, turn by turn. Man or woman, young or old, will stand before Allah Almighty. Allah Almighty will be the judge on that day. You will be standing in the box on that day. Witnesses will be against you on that day. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam will be for you on that day. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, one by one, his ummatis will come. Allah Almighty, it's like court. It is like, you know, court day, doomsday. It will be the day of doom for some people. It will be gloom for some people. But it will be bliss for others. You know, those mu'minun, Nabi alayhi salam said, there will be 70,000 people in my ummah who will enter into Jannatul Firdaus and Allah will not ask him a single question. Straight into Jannah. And with each one of them, there will be 70 more thousand people. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed us of those chosen people who will go to Jannah without questions. There will be some who will be questioned. And Allah Almighty will ask them everything. Nabi alayhi salam said, Allah will ask you about 5 things. Allah will ask you about your youth. What did you do when you was a young man? How did you spend your time as a youth? How did you earn your money? Where did you make your money from? How did you live your life? When you learned your knowledge, did you act upon this? Allah will ask you these questions. My youngsters, brothers and sisters, we are spending our lives, our youth, in darkness, in misguidance. Allah will specifically ask us about our youth. You know, our youth is such a precious time in our lifetime. When you're young, you can do so many things. When you're old, you can't do much. Don't waste your life in this youth. Don't waste your youth in this life that you have. Don't waste your youth. Spend your youth worshipping Allah Almighty. Spend your youth obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Spend your youth following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You only live once in this world, there is no doubt. But you will live another world. What you do here today, it will reflect on that day. What you do here today will reflect on that day. What we do here today, we will be shown on that day. We will see everything on that day. Allah will show us. This is what you did. This is what you did. And you know, in the Quran, Allah talks about this. يَوْمَ نَخْتِمُ عَلَىٰ أَفْوَاهِهِمْ وَتُكَلِّمُونَ عَيْدِيهِمْ. And on that day, Allah will seal their mouths. And Allah will ask him, Allah will say, keep his mouth quiet. Let his hands speak. Let his feet speak. You did wrong? Let the wall speak. Let the ground speak against him. What are you going to answer to that then? You know, all these walls, just because there's no camera on them, just because this ground doesn't have a camera, doesn't mean it doesn't have a mind to know what's going to happen. On that day, all these things around us will be our enemies. Don't make them your enemies. Make them your friends. Let them witness, let this ground, this land you're sitting on now, witness and say to Allah, he spent his lifetime in my house, in your house.
SubhanAllah, SubhanAllah.
He spent his lifetime in your house. He lived here. He spent his time here. He worshipped you on this place. Allah. On that day, what answers will we give to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You know, when you will stand, there will be some whose faces will be dark, others whose faces will be light. When Allah will give you your book of deeds, some who are pious will receive in their right hand, and those who receive it in their left hand and behind their backs, there will be no khair for those people. There will be no good left for those people. You know, when your actions will be weighed, when they put on the scales, if your good deeds outweigh your bad deeds, then you will go to Jannah al-Firdaws. But if your bad deeds outweigh your good deeds, then you will go to the fire of Jahannam. Hazrat, you know, when you think about this day, when you think you have no opportunity, you have nothing left in your heart to laugh, you wouldn't feel like laughing, you wouldn't feel like chilling out, your desires would stop. For one moment in the day, think about this, and you watch how your mentality will change. Just for one moment, you think about what's going to happen on that day. What answer, what face will you show to Allah? And you will sincerely begin to do tawbah. You will want to turn to Allah straight away and say, Ya Allah, before I die, forgive me. For if you forgive me, then I will be forgiven on that day. But if you don't forgive me here, on that day there will be no khair for me. Nothing can save me except the mercy of your Prophet and your mercy. Nothing can save me. And Rasulullah will save you if you are a true follower of him. If you truly love him, if you truly obey and follow him, if you truly do what he has asked us to do, not say that I love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and not even do what the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam did. Allahu Akbar, on that day, when matters will be settled. You know, on that day, if you wrong somebody here, it'll cure people. One day Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam was sat there, and Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam informed us, and said to the Sahaba, do you know who the bankrupt man is? He said, Ya Rasulullah, the one who has no money, he's bankrupt. Nabi alayhi salam said, no. You know, the bankrupt is he who will come on the day of judgment with so many good deeds. By the end of his reckoning and accountability, he will be left with nothing. He said, Ya Rasulullah, how? Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, you know how? He will come, all his good deeds. And Allah Almighty, there will be a queue of people against him. People used to lie, swear, harm, hurt, abuse, fought against. I want to say, Ya Allah, he swore at me. Allah will say, give him some deeds. Ya Allah, he lied. Give him some deeds. Ya Allah, he wronged my rights. Give him some of his good deeds. By the end, he will be left with nothing. When he has nothing to give, and there's still people still against him. Allahu Akbar. Allah Almighty will say, now you know what? Give your bad deeds to him. So he will take people's bad deeds. See, Allah is very fair and just. This is why, how important are the rights of humans? This is why they're important. Don't wrong nobody. Don't harm nobody. Don't swear at nobody. Today you make enemies with people, tomorrow they will be your enemies on the day of judgment. This is why be good with people. Don't have no enemies on that day. On that day people will, today they're your friends, tomorrow they'll be your enemies. Today you can have a laugh with them and spud them. Today you can meet them, swear at them, have a laugh with them. Do pranks on them. Tomorrow, you know, when the going gets hard, they're going to turn against you, man. They will go against you and say, Ya Allah, you know, though my friend in the dunya, you know, give me his deeds. And indeed, every person will be selfish on that day. On that day, man will go to his يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ. He will run from his mother, his father. Man will run from his sister, his brother, from his children, his wife. He will run from people. People will run, I don't want to know you. Nafsi, nafsi. Me, I'm on my own. Leave me alone. Today I'm worried about myself. Today you sit around in the dunya worrying about people. How sure can you be that on that day you will not worry about yourself? If you ain't sure that you ain't going to worry about yourself on that day, then you have the right to worry today about other people. Otherwise, stop worrying about other people and worry about yourself. Worry about yourself. And you know the final thing, Mawlai Kainat Mawla Ali radiallahu anhu said, he said, you know, إِذَا مَاتُوا قَدْ قَامَتْ قِيَامَتُوا. He said, you know, when you die, that's when Qiyamah begins. You know, when you die, after everything I've said about the Day of Judgment, and there are many more things to say, After all the signs that I mentioned, major and minor, all of these things, for about which and whom we might not even live to. Though people are always interested in these things. You know what the reality is? The reality is what Sayyidina Ali said. You know, when you die, that's when your day of judgment begins. That's the reality. When you die, that's when your judgment will begin. إِذَا مَاتُوا قَدْ قَامَتْ قِيَامَتُهُمْ. The Qiyamah will begin when they die. That is the main lesson of today's lecture. That when we die, that's when Qiyamah will begin. So stop worrying about when Dajjal will come. Stop worrying about when Isa alayhi salam will come. Stop worrying about all these major signs. Worry about your death. That's the bottom line. That is the bottom line. Worry about your death. Because when you die, that's when the Akhirah begins. The first stage of your hereafter is when you die. Everything I've told you, put that in the back of your head. This saying of Sayyidina Ali, إِذَا مَاتُوا فَقَدْ قَامَتْ قِيَامَتُهُمْ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ. When you die, when they will die, that is when the resurrection, that is when the Qiyamah will begin. That is when the accountability, that is when the day of judgment occurs for a person. The grave is the first day of judgment. First pass the grave, then worry about that day. What guarantee do we have that we pass the grave? I haven't even spoken about the grave today. Maybe on another day we'll talk about the grave. What will happen in the grave? How we should prepare for the grave? Don't worry about the day of judgment. Day of judgment is coming. Worry about the day of judgment in the grave. You know, when those two angels come and they will sit you up and say, who did you used to worship? Who is your Lord? What is your religion? What did you say about this great man sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? That is what will count and matter. That's where it begins. But even before then, you know where it begins? It begins now. It starts now. Now the change comes so that you're prepared for the day of judgment. You're prepared for the grave, and then in the grave, all the way to the day of judgment, and then the day of judgment, you can stand. And may Allah make us amongst those who are pious.
Amen.
Amongst the pious servants who have been promised Jannah.
Amen.
Allah make us from the people of Jannah.
Amen.
People of khair and bad.
Amen.
Allah forgive us for our major and minor sins.
Amen.
And have mercy on us before we die.
Amen.
And certainly in our grave.
Amen.
And on the day of Qiyamah.
Amen.
And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant each and every one of us the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on that day. And ultimately enters into Jannah al-Firdaus with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah give us all tawfiq to do sincere repentance before we die.
Amen.
Allah accept our repentance from us.
Amen.
Give us tawfiq not to return back to our bad deeds and bad ways.
Amen.
Allah turn us into good people.
Amen.
Pious people.
Amen.
Pious servant of His.
Wa
aqulu qawli hadha astaghfirullah wa lakum. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل يا أيها الكافرون لا أعبد ما تعبدون ولا أنتم عابدون ما أعبد ولا ولا أنتم عابدون ما أعبد لكم دينكم ولي دين. الله أكبر. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. الله أكبر. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. الله أكبر. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. الله أكبر بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل أعوذ برب الفلق من شر ما خلق ومن شر غاسق إذا وقب ومن شر النفاثات في العقد ومن شر حاسد إذا حسد الله أكبر بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل أعوذ برب الناس ملك الناس إله الناس من شر الوسواس الخناس الذي يوسوس في صدور الناس من الجنة والناس الله أكبر بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم اهدنا الصراط المستقيم اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام ميم ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب ويقيمون الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون والذين يؤمنون بما أنزل إليك وما أنزل من قبلك وبالآخرة هم يوقنون أولئك على هدى من ربهم وأولئك هم المفلحون بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وسلم عليه.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. والله ما يجي تدعو وسيلة of the Prophet صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم forgive us for our sins and كبيرة هنا. الله ما يجي وسيلة النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام The brothers and sisters who have gathered here today, Allah Almighty Rasul of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, bless each and every one of us with your rahmah and your barakah. Oh Allah, the brothers who have left this dunya, Allah Almighty, from the mu'minun, muslimun, Allah Almighty, grant them all a place in Jannat al-Firdaus. Allah Almighty, and particularly the brothers who have requested dua for one brother who passed away in Birmingham, another brother who passed away, I think, in Birmingham as well, two brothers who passed away in Birmingham. Allah Almighty, through the seal of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we make dua that you grant both of them Jannat al-Firdaus. Allah Almighty, those who are ill, grant them Shifa'i Kamil.
Amen.
Allah Almighty, grant them Shifa'i Ajila.
Amen.
Allah Almighty, your brothers who had an operation in Blackman, grant them Shifa'i Ajila.
Amen.
Allah Almighty, the sister who is ill in hospital, Allah Almighty, grant her Shifa'i Ajila.
Amen.
Allah Almighty, grant her Sayyidi Kamila. Allah Almighty, the seal of Rasulullah, forgive us for our Saghira and Kabira Huna. Allah, any du'as that we have that are good for us, accept our du'as. Allah, to the seal of Rasulullah, grant us a place in Jannat al-Firdaus. Allah, give us tawfiq to remember the day of Qiyamah. Allah, to the seal of Rasulullah, grant us all iman and yaqeen and ilm kamil. Allah, to the seal of Rasulullah, we ask you to grant us martyrdom in your way, Allah Almighty, and a place in the city of your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. اللهم ارزقنا شهادة في سبيلك واجعل موتنا في بلد رسولك. اللهم ارزقنا حبك ومن يحبك. اللهم ارزقنا حب عمل يقربنا إليك. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. اللهم حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل. نعم المولى ونعم النصير. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. بفضل إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي. يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا وحبيبنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين. الحمد لله رب العالمين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.